Hi everyone, I'm JD, the Chief Learning Architect at Exonify, and I'm here to help you fix learning measurement. That might be an overpromise, a little bit of an overpromise. But what we're going to talk about today is shattering the way we think about measurement when it comes to workplace learning, workplace training. This conversation is based on an article that I wrote in June for CLO Magazine that you may have seen. That's also available in the additional resources for this conversation. But it's all about tackling a concept that I believe has been plaguing workplace learning for the better part of two decades, if not longer at this point. I know my entire time in workplace training, we've been talking about someday we need to get better at measurement. We're past someday. And someday is definitely right now. So hopefully if you've joined this conversation or you're watching this recording, you also want to solve the learning measurement problem. So let's dive in. Truth is, we know. Most organizations say that the inability to measure the impact of what we do in learning and development is fundamentally causing a problem when it comes to achieving the outcomes that we're being held accountable to and that organizations want our help to try to achieve. So the learning measurement problem is not a well-kept secret. I rarely run into an organization that says, we have solved the learning measurement problem. It's something that I believe our entire industry and everyone who works in training in any way struggles with or recognizes that there's a limitation or wishes that we could do more when it comes to the way that we connect what we do to meaningful change in our organizations and the results that the organization wants to achieve. The question is usually not if we want to get better at measurement. Question is why now, or how do we prioritize, or why should we prioritize measurement when there's no shortage of things to do, especially right now when it comes to the rapid transformation that organizations are going through? Where does measurement fit into this grand puzzle, and how do we get better at it but still keep doing what we need to do and addressing the needs that are brought to us and fulfilling the requests that stakeholders are making and sending in our direction? There's three, I think, ideas that we all have to align with, or three realities that we all have to face when it comes to the connection between what we do in training and the idea of measurement. The first one is people have options. We are not the only game in town when it comes to people's ability to find the information they need or to develop the knowledge and skills that are going to help them do their jobs better. There are now a variety of options out there, whether it be an individual employee seeking out additional options or stakeholders looking at options beyond the work that you may do as a corporate training person. Second reality is that we will be held accountable. Just like every other function in the business, there are expectations that we have to meet, KPIs that we are held accountable to. For a very long time, a lot of those KPIs have been completions, or perhaps it's average number of hours of training delivered per employee per year. I know one role that I was in, that number was actually in our publicly available shareholder report. How many hours of training did we deliver that year? I don't know if you're like me, but I know that that means nothing. If we delivered 3 hours of training per employee per year, or we delivered 30 hours of training per employee per year, that doesn't say anything. It says people spent time doing stuff, but what did that time actually get them in terms of their ability to perform? So just like our peers in marketing, in sales, in information technology, people are looking at us more and more to show the value that we bring to an organization. And then finally, if we want to get better at our jobs, if we want to advance our practices, if we want to take advantage of some of the newer technological capabilities, if we want to leverage artificial intelligence and machine learning, if we want to increase automation in order to improve our efficiency so that we can focus on the right problems and put our skills in the right areas based on what our business needs us to do, we have to get better at data. If we don't have data and we haven't fixed measurement, we can't advance our practices in a lot of meaningful ways. And what it comes down to is there's a gap in the traditional models. This is the Kirkpatrick model, one of the few things that I think everyone in our industry universally knows. But the problem isn't the Kirkpatrick model. The Kirkpatrick model and other learning measurement models are not fundamentally wrong. The issue is, if I had a nickel for every time I heard someone say, yeah, but we can't get to level 3 and 4, I'd have a lot of nickels. So what's the problem? Why can't we get to those levels of measurement, or why can't we sustain that? Or in some cases, we do get to the completion of the model, to all four levels of the model. But it takes a lot of time and a lot of effort and a lot of resources to get there. So what's wrong with the models? I don't think there's anything wrong with the models. I think we're in a square peg round hole situation when it comes to measurement nowadays. A lot of the measurement models we're talking about have been around for a very long time, when learning traditionally looked like this. When it was about place and time, whether it be job training programs, whether it be classroom-based programs, a lot of the models were built for that world. Now the world looks a little bit more like this, where there's a blend to the experience of learning. Like I said, people have options, whether it be content that we deliver or content they access in other ways. So the world of how people train at work, how people learn and develop their skills has changed, but the models have largely stayed the same or are rooted in the same principles. And as a result, our shelves are empty when it comes to the data we need to improve our measurement. And we're now at a point when it comes to trying to make the models work and force the square peg into the round hole, that we're getting close to what Einstein said the definition of insanity is, where we're expecting a better result by just trying to use the same tools in different ways while the world around those tools is changing. So I firmly believe the answer is not the traditional models. It's not the solutions we've been trying for a long time. Like I said, those models were built for a certain time. They work very effectively in that time, and or they work for very specific applications. But they're not going to fundamentally solve the challenge we have when it comes to connecting what we do to meaningful results for our employees and then meaningful results for our organizations. So if we want to get those empty shelves stocked with the right data, with meaningful data that's going to power us forward and help us advance our practices and improve the value that we deliver to our organizations, we don't need a new model. We need a new mindset. We need to think differently about how measurement works in workplace learning, and then how we tackle the challenge in order to get to those results we're trying to achieve. That's harder than saying, here's the new model. If you just do these five steps, then we'll be able to fix measurement, especially when it comes to the front line, because the frontline workforce spends most of their time focusing on your products and your customers. They don't go through the traditional training programs on a regular basis. Learning is a much more blended experience on the front line. So it's not about finding one model that works for every possible frontline workplace. Because if you think about it again, a store associate in a retail environment, it's a very different experience than working in a manufacturing facility, than working in a contact center, than working as a delivery driver, than working in a healthcare facility. It's about rethinking the way that we look at the role measurement plays in helping us evolve our strategies when it comes to workplace training. But there's good news. It's a hard conversation, but there's good news. We're not the first people to tackle this problem. One of our peer groups, another department inside of our organizations, has already gone through this journey and has come out the other side showing what is possible when you rethink the role that measurement and data plays in your practices. And that's marketing. If you think about, maybe some of you have been in marketing, support a marketing team. If you think about marketing 20-ish years ago, before the internet became a ubiquitous part of our everyday lives, marketing was similar to learning and development from a traditional tactics perspective. It was a lot about place and time. It was about putting an ad in a certain place, whether it be on the radio, on television, in print ads, and on billboards. And trying to find a way to get as many eyes as possible to that place and time. And in a lot of cases, making assumptions about the impact of that content, in this case of those advertisements, based on that amount of presumed exposure. Billboards being a great example. You can count how many cars drive past that billboard on the average day. But how do you connect that potential exposure, if someone looked at the billboard, to a change in behavior that results in a purchase of a product. You can't. You're left with loose connections, similar to the way that if we deliver a class, how can we assume that because someone attended that class or they completed and clicked through that e-learning, that the change in behavior is going to happen and it's going to result in the business result we're looking to achieve. Very similar story. Now, if you fast forward in time, 20 years later, has marketing got better at measuring billboards? They really haven't. I mean, they've gotten better billboards. That's completely true. But the billboard story is still pretty similar, but they don't lean on place and time advertising as much as they once did. The internet and digital capabilities, mobile technology, social technology, allowed marketing to fundamentally rethink how they did their jobs. The goal remained the same. Look for ways to nudge people in a direction to help people change behavior in order to get them to consider a certain brand, to build a certain message, to buy a certain product. Similar story with us. And it actually very recently worked on me. I sometimes pride myself in not being manipulated by advertising, not being trendy. You can probably look at me and tell that. But there was one product where marketing and their data-driven practices really worked. And that's the chair that I'm sitting in right now. A couple of months back, I decided, as someone who works from home traditionally, that I should invest in a better chair because I had been using the same chair for several years. And you sit in the chair all day. At some point, you need a better chair. So I had done some basic searching on desk chairs. And then Instagram, one day, as I'm scrolling, presented me the only ad that I have ever taken immediate action on in order to purchase a particular product. Because it showed me this image. It showed me this chair. Not only was I looking for a chair at the time and it fit that need, but somehow Instagram knew that for the past 20 years or so, I've been making purchases based on one criteria. Which one would Batman buy? Not Bruce Wayne, Batman. I've purchased a cell phone that way. I've purchased a car that way. And somehow Instagram knew I was going to purchase a chair based on the chair that Batman would buy. So if you look at the chair I'm sitting in right now, I'm sitting in Batman's chair. Because marketing has advanced to such a degree, they understood and were mildly creepy with presenting me what would be the right chair for me. We're not going to get to that extreme. I'm not saying we should do the exact same things that marketing is doing. But how do we learn from their story so that we can get the employees that we support the right resources so they can do their best work safely and productively every day? And how can then we leverage that capability to advance our practices and demonstrate the value that we provide to our organizations? So I want to walk you down a bit of a journey, share some ideas and some steps that you can take if you agree with what I've said so far, that it's not about finding one model, it's about rethinking measurement and rethinking data based on your organization, the experience that your employees need, and what you're trying to achieve as the training function within your business. Hopefully, these ideas will help you find an approach and maybe a model that can be the best fit for what you need to do as a training team. So the first step I recommend is recognizing that measurement is not a series of layers, it's a continuous reality. The marketing team that sold me this chair didn't ask me a year and a half ago about my chair preferences, and then a year and a half later when I needed a chair, go back to that one moment in time and provide me a chair. It might have still been a Batman chair, let's be honest. But it was about continuously assessing the changes in my preferences and my needs, knowing that at this moment in time, I was looking for a chair and solving that problem. So how do we do something similar when it comes to looking at the experience of the people we support, especially as it changes as it has right now, and find a way to use data continuously to improve the way that we provide that support? So that's why I believe we have to step away from models that look at measurement as a programmatic thing, as something that we do in bits and pieces here and there. Maybe we measure certain programs. Instead, looking at how do we measure the continuous experience of the workplace, of learning at work. Because learning is continuous, therefore measurement should be a continuous idea. So it's not about layers, it's more about a circle. It's about continuously assessing how are people engaging in learning opportunities? What resources are they leveraging and getting value from, and what are they maybe not? It's about looking at how people's knowledge is changing over time. Because people learn, they forget. Learning isn't a straight up and to the right idea. It's a little bit dirtier than that. It goes up and down. People remember, they forget. People go to training, they evolve their skills, they learn on the job, not just from our experiences. So how are people's knowledge changing over time, and how can that inform our strategies? Likewise, how is that knowledge changing on the job behavior? Because just because people complete a training or just because they know doesn't mean they're doing it, doesn't mean they're doing it consistently. So we also have to measure how people are performing on the job. What results are people seeing? So it's not just about training-related data. It's also about the results that people are achieving when it comes to KPIs on the job. What are those outcomes? And then how can that data help us continuously evolve, look forward in terms of what we need to be able to provide, get more proactive in our approach, and then adapt on the fly? Again, not just as part of a one particular program moment in time, but continuously. Really understand the changing needs of the frontline workforce and allow us to get there at least at pace, if not ahead of those changing needs. So looking at the mindset shift from measurement as something programmatic and something that attaches itself to specific initiatives to something that is continuous and ongoing, and that continuous feed, that continuous measurement informs the different initiatives, different strategies, different priorities that we're going to face as we move forward. Step two. Determine which problems data can help you solve. It's not just about getting data for the sake of getting data. It's about connecting data and measurement to meaningful problems and priorities within our organizations. So maybe your priority might be related to compliance, right? You might have to measure certain types of knowledge, skill, completions as part of this story. We're not getting rid of some of the things we traditionally measure because those are important. In some cases, checking a box is a form of measurement. So maybe it's about regulatory considerations that are going to be one of your priorities. Maybe it's about product considerations, process considerations, experience considerations, other things that are going on that you want to move the needle on. Maybe one of your major priorities is investment, is justifying value, is trying to work with stakeholders and your senior executive team to show that you are having an impact on the business that makes it worth the investment in your frontline, in continuous training, in order to deliver even more value to the business. And it's probably not one priority. There's probably a short list of priorities, but it can't be about measurement for the sake of measurement. It's really identifying what are those priorities for your training team that are gonna power you forward and inform how you approach measurement and how you build your own measurement model moving forward. So you have to make sure you understand what your priority is going to be, how that connects to data and measurement. Step three, expanding your definition of data. We already talked about that a little bit in terms of that continuous cycle of measurement, that learning is continuous. So our measurement of the experience of learning, of evolving your knowledge and skills should also be continuous. But traditionally, we look at data kind of in two buckets. There's learning data or training data. Things that traditionally are scores, completions, seat times, maybe experience data that comes out of completing an e-learning module, where people clicked, right, where they spent their time, these types of ideas. But that's data that we generate from our experiences, the things that we create. Then there's a wall. And the other side is this thing called business data, right? And we try to get access to the business data, but sometimes it's hard to get to. Maybe stakeholders aren't used to providing business data, KPI, sales data, customer satisfaction data to the training team, because it's not something we usually work with. We don't quite know where to find it. Maybe it's spread out across the business in different divisions. But we often create that dividing line between our data and their data. That's a fundamentally problematic part of our story, because in reality, we should be looking at data as a whole, as a unified concept, where some of that data is generated through activities that we help create, but a lot of that data already exists inside the business and other places. So it's about bringing the data story together and not talking about learning data and business data, but talking about different categories of data within the organization, whether it be related to productivity on the business side per se. Behavioral data, things that are happening on the job. Learning data, data that comes out of training experiences. Demographic data, data about the people we're supporting, that HR type of data. But bringing that entire story together and talking about data as a whole, rather than segmenting it unnecessarily, and then making it more challenging to get access to the different types of data we need. And again, it comes back to thinking about data more like a marketing professional would. So thinking about data in terms of velocity, you know, what data is generated quickly that we might need to get access to, that data comes from the experience of working on the job, the variety of data that we need access to in order to tell our story. When you think about that circular diagram from before, not just the data we generate within training experiences, but other forms of data to really complete that cycle of measurement. The trustworthiness of the data that we're collecting, the different types of sources, and making sure that we're pulling in data that actually is meaningful, not just data, again, for the sake of data. The scale of data, right? Where is data available at the volumes that are needed, and what data is of clear value that's going to help us transform our practices and accomplish those goals and reach those priorities that are informing how we're approaching measurement. And this is a big partnership moment. There's a couple of these moments in this conversation where we don't have to do this alone, right? You may be a small and mighty training team that wants to advance your measurement practices, understands how important this can be, but maybe you don't have a lot of expertise. So you are leaning on traditional models for those reasons. You don't have to go out and hire a data scientist to get better at measurement. If you work in a large organization, you have data scientists. They might not work in human resources or training. So how do we reach out to people who understand data, who understand the data we have as an organization, who are using data in different ways to power their own strategies? It could be your marketing team. Reach out and start having those conversations before we need to ask for data to understand what is out there. How is data being used? What systems are being used in order to track and store and apply data? We may be able to leverage some of those same resources to help shape our own story. So it's not something we have to do alone. It's not something you have to necessarily make a major investment in right away. Maybe you do have the benefit of being a very large training team where you might have the ability to have your own data science team, your own machine learning team. That's great too. But I've never had that luxury in the various roles that I've worked. It's always been about partnering and learning about data capabilities from people who are proven experts, and then improving my own knowledge and skills so that I can apply that data in the right way. So not becoming a data scientist, but getting smart enough and dangerous enough with my ability to apply my understanding of data to the problems I face as a learning professional. Next step, identifying the specific data you're going to need. So we've identified our priorities. We're looking out there to see what the broader potential of data is, expanding beyond just data created in training experiences. So now it's a question of what data are you going to need? This is another one of those situations where I can't say, here are the four types of data that you need to fix measurement in training, because it depends on your situation, what data is available to you, and what your priorities are, what problems you're going to try to solve through the application of measurement and data. But some ideas could be some of the data we traditionally already have. So demographic data, understanding who we're supporting, details about the people, the role that they play in your organization. Consumption data, right? What resources are they accessing? What training have they completed? That's going to be part of our story, but a small part. The feedback from people. We want to understand where they're seeing benefit, maybe in some cases where there are preferences. But it's not just about, well, if people like it, therefore it had impact. But we still want to understand people's impressions and opinions of the resources we're providing. Context is an important piece of data. What is happening around an individual that may inform their performance? Seasonality is a great example, right? If you work in a retail environment, understanding how seasonality influences performance helps inform the story of how people are or are not achieving results. Because the story around a traditional holiday period is very different than more of an off-season period. So understanding context, what's happening around an individual. How are people connecting through the organization, right? There's a lot of conversation about data that relates to how people connect, who people go to for answers, how people are finding or collaborating with one another in order to overcome challenges and solve problems. So that's a potential source of data. Microsoft, as an example, does a lot with that type of data across their 365 suite of tools. Knowledge, we already talked about. this? How are we measuring what people know, right? Are they ready to be able to apply that knowledge in order to solve problems, answer questions as they arise? What are people actually doing on the job? Because it's not enough to know. If we train them and if they know the information, are they actually doing it in real life? And what could be creating gaps potentially in their real world performance? And results, the more traditional business data, right? What are people being held accountable to in terms of outcomes on the job, and how does that feed in? So that's just an example set of data that may be a useful part of your story. But again, it really depends on your picture, your priorities, and what data is accessible to you, both in the experiences you're creating, as well as the other parts of the organization. Next step, adopt data-rich tactics. I believe this may be the most important part of the conversation, because this is where a tremendous amount of our kind of measurement capability falls down. And if we go back to that story about marketing, right, a lot of their capability came through the adoption of data-rich tools, data-rich capabilities, data-rich tactics. Rather than just rely on place and time, billboard-type tactics, marketing rapidly adopted digital. They adopted the internet. They adopted social tools, mobile technology, much more quickly and effectively than we have traditionally in learning and development. So how do we make a similar transition, break out of our place and time approach to training, and adopt a new set of tools or augment our existing tactics in order to introduce capabilities that will help us get to the data that we need when it comes to measuring the different types of things we talked about so far? So if you look at the learning experience for a traditional frontline employee, if we do lean on traditional tactics like event-based training in a classroom over a Zoom session, online content, but it's more the traditional online course e-learning type experience, or maybe training experiences they complete on the job, there's a natural limitation to the amount of data we can get. If you're in a classroom, I can maybe measure some of the experience while you're in the room. Maybe you're going to take a test, complete an assessment. I might send you a survey. But there's a natural limitation there. Same with e-learning content, same with job training. Those are fundamentally data poor tactics. So it's about augmenting the experience of training and making data and measurement part of that more continuous learning experience. So maybe that's on-demand resources. If you're leveraging an intranet, a knowledge base, are we measuring how people are leveraging resources, what they're using, what they're not using, and what different parts of the organization may be using in different ways? Tactics like reinforcement, right? If people are completing just a couple of minutes of additional training, challenge exercises, practice exercises, how is their knowledge and capability changing over time? Data from coaching experiences, getting insight from managers into how people are performing on the job. Performance data, again, that real world business execution productivity type data. Data in terms of how people are leveraging or accessing messaging, right? Not just about training, how people are leveraging different resources on the job and providing feedback about these experiences, about how prepared they feel to do their job. So a variety of different ways to think about using continuous learning tactics as additional data sources in order to grow the types of data and the volume of data and the speed with which we can collect data in order to inform our measurement story. That'll help us achieve the results we're looking to achieve. And again, another partnership moment, because it doesn't just have to be about our ability to access data. It's about looking at the overall work experience of your audience, of your frontline employees, and saying, where are there moments where there's potential access to data points that help us improve our measurement story? So if they're working in, let's say, a manufacturing facility, there might be efficiency measures that are already being already occurring that we can take advantage of. Maybe they're leveraging an intranet as part of something your corporate communications team, your marketing team, your HR team is leveraging, asking about the data that is being accessed as part of that experience, right? So it's not, again, about us having to figure all this out on our own. It's about reaching out to our partners internally and then also potentially reaching out to your partners externally, your learning technology providers, as an example, and asking how can we potentially leverage our existing tools or maybe new tools in order to introduce new data-rich tactics. Or if you're exploring different technology options, earlier today, I had a session about building a technology ecosystem. Are you including data as part of your decision-making process, right? Challenging your solution providers and your partners to see how can they help you improve your data-rich tactics, collect the right types of data that are going to help you solve those meaningful problems. So it's about working together with all of our resources, not just figuring this out all by ourselves. Step six, not just about data-rich tactics, but it's also as we build solutions, are they data-rich solutions? Are we taking the right steps in our solution design process when we're building courses, when we're building assets, when we're building videos, to make sure that we have the ability to measure the impact of those solutions? And this is a design model that I talk about a lot, and we talk about a lot at Exonify, which is connecting the dots between the solutions that we make and the results we're trying to achieve as a business. And it comes down to connecting the dots from what results we're trying to achieve, what the outcomes are, to what people do on the job, what people know, and then the solution that's going to help drive those changes. So are we, as we're building a solution and working with stakeholders and partners, are we agreeing on a measurable outcome, what we're trying to achieve as a result of the work that we're doing? What is the change in behavior that's expected? What does it look like if people do what they're supposed to do on the job in order to achieve those results? If we took a picture of good, what would it look like? Really defining that behavioral expectation. That often is a challenging conversation, but a very important conversation if we want to fix our ability to measure and then use data to power our solutions. Then in order to do those things on the job, what do people have to know? What's the foundational knowledge? So if we're expecting a reduction in safety incidents, and the behavior we expect on the job is people to lift effectively based on established lifting practices, they have to know what a good lift looks like, how to use the tools, what tools are available to them in order to improve the way they're lifting on the job. And then with that understanding, with that chain connected, we can then determine what the right solution is in order to address that problem, help people improve their knowledge and skill, improve their behavior on the job, and then get to the result. And then the great thing, it helps us build a more right fit solution. And then it works backwards in the other direction, where it's going to help us measure changes in knowledge based on our solution, measure changes in behavior based on our solution, and then connect those changes to changes in results and help us show the value and the impact of that solution and get more proactive. Because if we see gaps along the way, if knowledge, behavior, and outcomes are not changing, we can get proactive and adjust our solution rather than find out at the end and realize that it wasn't the best investment of resources. And finally, step seven, start small. Right? Fixed measurement is a big potential conversation. You have a lot of things going on, right? Prioritizing measurement may seem very challenging unless you're being held to a very specific change in accountability. Maybe your organization's looking for more than seat time and completions, and this is maybe going to be a big priority for you moving in to the next year. But if you're trying to figure out where does this fit, how do I get started, right? Like I said, it's not about applying a new model and rapidly replacing all of your tactics, replacing your design process. But maybe it's about pieces of that. Maybe it's looking hard at the learning experience on the front line and saying, where could we be leveraging data more effectively? Where could we be introducing a tactic that's going to improve our ability to measure? Maybe it's looking at your design process and saying, well, if we do clarify that expected change in behavior, it would be much easier to measure, or be able to really integrate our ability to measure behavior change with the observations that are already being done on the floor that managers are already doing. We can really build these pieces together to improve our measurement capability. But it really comes down to starting small, finding these moments in time where you can improve elements of your measurement capability to start a conversation, and then start to show people, both within your own training team, as well as your stakeholders, what you can do when you start to think differently about the role of data and the role of measurement when it comes to building right fit training solutions. And I have an example. When I worked in a contact center environment, I was going down this path of trying to figure out, how do I connect the dots, right? How do I get access to better data to start advancing my practices and really show that what we're doing is working, that these training programs are having the desired impact. But had a lot of other things going on, and I'm not, like I said, a data scientist, and I was very new to the data conversation. I was using a lot of traditional models and trying to make them work. But then I did one thing, We were building a knowledge base. We had identified that access to timely information was a major problem in our contact center environment. So we were building out what amounted to a large wiki platform that ultimately had 70,000 pieces of content in it after a couple of years of this project. And the idea was if people could quickly get to meaningful, easy to use information, they wouldn't necessarily always need structured training, and we could focus our training efforts in more meaningful areas and then leverage this knowledge base to provide timely performance support, those types of ideas. And when we were building out that wiki, early days, I plugged Google Analytics into that wiki. This is just an example screenshot for visual purposes. But in this case, we were using a really accessible, cheap technology that was the wiki, and I plugged in free Google Analytics. I couldn't track everything I potentially wanted to track. We didn't start by saying, well, how does accessing this article help people get a better satisfaction score in this particular product area? We couldn't make those connections early days. I just wanted to change the conversation from what training did people complete, right? Or what scores did they get? Or did they pass the test when they first got trained? I want to start talking about data in a more proactive way that could inform the way we were addressing our solutions. So by plugging Google Analytics in, I was able to take a look at how traffic was moving through this wiki. A lot of website type analytics, if you've ever used Google Analytics. Really figuring out what pages were people going to? How are people navigating between articles? And even one of the most important things I can now track was what were people searching for and where did those searches lead? So it allowed me to look at search metrics and say, why are so many people looking for this topic, right? How are they using this information? Is there a gap, right? Is there something we should be training them on that we're not? Or if they're searching for this particular topic and they often have to search again or refine their search or they can't find what they're looking for, is there a gap in our knowledge base that we should be filling in? No one's telling me we have a problem with this topic, but the data is starting to show me trends in behavior, starting to show me how people are using information, not just what they're completing, and allowed me to change the conversation with my training team, get more proactive, and use data to ask really meaningful questions about what people were doing on the job for the first time. And it allowed us to then really push the conversation forward and start looking at data differently, and then start to get a little bit more aggressive about how we were inserting new tactics, inserting daily reinforcement to measure changes in knowledge, looking at quality assurance and how people were evaluating calls and how that data fed into the decisions we were making as a training team. But it all came back to just plugging a free data tool into our knowledge base and taking a look at what the data showed me and asking some meaningful questions to get people thinking differently about how measurement could be used to improve the training we are delivering to our contact center agents. So hopefully that's a simple example that gives you a little bit of maybe an idea about how you can take a simple step to really start that conversation within your organization. But that's it. 7 steps, like I said, it's not necessarily a process. It's not do these 7 things and you'll have fixed measurement, but it's 7 different ideas that will hopefully help you and your team start to think differently, shift your mindset away from trying to force traditional tools or think that you're doing something wrong because the traditional model isn't working for you. Start thinking differently about data. Take inspiration from others in our organizations, partner with other people, whether it be inside your business or the partners that you work with, teams like at Exonify, and start working your way down a path where we can leverage data to improve our practices, advance what we're able to do, take advantage of new capabilities, and show the value we're delivering to our organization. And the question then becomes, where does this go, right? What becomes possible when you really go down the path, do a lot of the things we've talked about today? One of the things that we do with the teams we work with at Exonify is something called impact analysis. I showed that visual before about connecting the solution to the outcome for the business. We work with a variety of organizations to do everything I talked about, install data-rich tactics, create continuous flow of data measurement, measure changes in what people are completing in terms of training, how knowledge is changing over time in a very specific way, how that relates to behavior change, and then connect that to business results. We actually run that through AI-based technology, through machine learning algorithms that we build that suit each individual organization that we work with that leverages our impact capability. And then connects the dots to say, to what degree is training having an impact on their business results? Surprise, the answer is never 100%. 100% of sales results is never based on training. But when you can walk through the door and say, of this total pie, of all the sales results we saw this quarter, this sliver is based on the work that we did in training. That's a very powerful position to come from in terms of justifying the investment in training. And it gives you an understanding of what is and isn't working, so you can proactively adjust your strategy to make sure you're providing right fit solutions. So we actually took a lot of this data, and about a year ago, we did a study where we took a year's worth of data from a variety of organizations and really took a look at what was the connection between training and the results they were seeing as a business. So we looked at data from 260,000 employees, 18 million training sessions over 12 months of time. And what we saw was training impacting different types of business results, different types of priorities, different things organizations wanted to accomplish in different ways. So in some cases, quality assurance is an example. 2% of the results that these organizations were seeing in quality assurance was based on training. But 2% can be a very large number, depending on how that relates to your business goals. But then you look at productivity. 39% of results seen as related to productivity measures were connected directly to what they were doing in training. And on average, we saw 29% of business results connected directly to the training solutions these organizations were providing. Simply stated, if you stopped the training, there's the potential for the organization to lose 29% of their business results. So if you're a sales team, that's 29% of your revenue gone because you weren't providing training in the right ways. Again, a very powerful position to come from, not just about justifying ROI, not just about investment, but it gives you the ability to get that much more strategic and proactive when you understand what is and isn't working within your business. So just an example of a study that we'll provide as an additional resource to help you see how far this can go when you really advance your measurement practices. So again, coming back to maybe you're here with me today, you've come this far on the session, so hopefully you're agreeing with some of the things that I'm saying, but maybe you're still frustrated by how do I justify this conversation? How do I prioritize? How do I bring this back to people that aren't here today? Well, one, the recording, feel free to share that. Additional resources, the presentation, feel free to share with your peers. But it comes back to that why. Why is measurement important? Why is it critical? Why is it the main problem that workplace training teams should be addressing now after decades of saying we will eventually figure out how to fix measurement? One, like I said, we're being held accountable even more so than ever. When budgets get tighter and tighter, training often gets put under the microscope. But if we can show that not only have we been a key piece of business results to date, but that moving forward, we're going to be able to help the business evolve, help the business grow, help the business survive through disruption, we are much likely to get more likely to get the investment we need to do our job as opposed to slim down or fight just to keep what we have today. Like I've said multiple times, it helps us get more proactive. It's not just about ROI or impact on the business. It's about using data to get better at what we do. So when we have the connection, when we know what is and isn't working and how people are actually taking advantage of and benefiting from our solutions, we can get more proactive with how we build those solutions. It's going to help us advance our practices, take advantage of new technologies, artificial intelligence that require data to power those solutions, and ultimately help us keep pace with change. That's one of the great things that data is really enabling within the marketing profession, is they can identify quickly changes in consumer behavior and preference and rapidly adjust their strategies. Business is moving around us faster than ever. Data is going to be a critical part of helping us keep up. So to summarize, I firmly believe a one-size-fits-all model is not the answer. There's not going to be a four-layer structure that's going to work for every business. It's about taking these different ideas and practices, working with your partners, and finding an approach that helps you fix your learning measurement problem. So thank you again for joining me as part of Exonicom Live. Feel free to reach out if you have any questions, want to dive into more conversations about measurement and data. Happy to do so. Otherwise, enjoy the Exonicom Live experience. Thank you very much for everything you're doing for the front line. Be safe, be kind to the front line, and be well, everybody.